was really happy at the start. We slept here all night by the mom. And the mom's going to be looking at two more questions in the light.
Yes, thank you. So for this lecture, I will focus on three main issues here. Climate change, ocean acidification, and ocean desalination. So we talk about the impact of climate change on the first levels of the trophic fluids. We talk about changes in pH and ocean acidification, and the last part of the talk will be ocean desalination. So I start with very few general slides. I start with these iconic figures, not maybe as famous as the killing curve that Raghu showed you this morning. But you have here the mean, or the average temperature, sea surface temperature, evolution from 1860 to 2000, reconstructed by several groups here. And you clearly see this warming of up to 1 degree over the past century. So we'll be looking at the impact of this warming and the changes in ocean dynamics that are partly due to the warming onto marine biotic industry and the lower traffic levels. The other big change in the ocean that is also due to increasing CO2, but that is not climate change per se, is ocean acidification. And we have here a record of surface ocean pH at one specific location, the Bat Station, which is localized in the Sargasso Sea. And we have direct measurements of ocean pH from the beginning of the 80s here to today, and we clearly see, despite this strong gravity, we clearly see this decreasing pH of the ocean surface waters as recorded here at BATS. Over the last 50 years, the ocean has lost maybe 0.1 pH units. And of course, this is due to the fact that the ocean is absorbing part of the anthropogenic CO2. So those are two big changes here only at the ocean surface: warming and acidification. So this graphic here comes from the last IPCC report in 2007, and it's a schematic that shows you the different physical and chemical changes that are happening today in the ocean. You have a warmer ocean here, mostly in the tropical but also at mid and high latitudes. You have, of course, reduced sea ice extents. You have freshening of high and mid latitude waters, so also changes in the salinity. And you have the chemical changes that I was mentioning. Decreasing pH, that's the yellow circles here. And you have also a showing of the saturation horizon for calcite and aragonite. We'll come back to that in the lecture where I will mention ocean acidification. So that's the chemical and physical changes in the ocean that are both due to increasing greenhouse gases in one case, that's the physical changes, and to only increasing CO2 in the other case, that's acidification. So there are other changes, large scale changes, that will have impacts on marine biogeochemistry, changes in the nutrient delivery to the ocean. We have here two maps from a model work published in 2008 by Duce et al. That show how much the nutrient delivery of nitrogen to the ocean has changed over the past decades, maybe multiplied by 4 or 5 from the natural nitrogen delivery to the ocean in 1860 to now almost 4 times higher numbers here. And of course, this difference is due to combustion and to agriculture that will put nitrogen in the atmosphere and that will be delivered to the ocean. So that's mostly, that's atmospheric deposition only, and you have, of course, another source of nutrient to the ocean, which are the rivers. And one clear impact of nutrient delivery, or increasing nutrient delivery by the rivers, is what has been here documented by Diaz and Rosenberg in 2008. It's an increasing number of coastal gentrification sites and hypoxia. So they've looked and they've gathered here all the sites that have undergone eutrophication and hypoxia, and that's clearly linked to increasing nutrient delivery. So if we summarize all the basically major drivers that are changing ocean biogeochemical cycles today, you have here carbon dioxide directly that affects ocean chemistry and that will drive ocean acidification. Then carbon dioxide, but also the other greenhouse gases, change the climate. That will, of course, alter primary convolution, for example, but all biogeochemical cycles. And then you have what I was just mentioning, increasing nutrient delivery by rivers, but also by atmospheric deposition here, that drive coastal eutrophication, but that may also change global scale chronic pollution in the ocean. So in this lecture today, I will focus only on those topics here. I will show you how climate change may alter chronic pollution in the ocean. Then I will focus on acidification, I'll show you how the models project changes in acidification and ocean chemistry in the next decades. And I will also mention in the last part of the talk quite a new subject, deoxygenation, that can be caused both by climate change, changes in circulation and warming of the ocean, but also by acidification. And to do that, I will make use of the recent simulations by the IPCC class models that have been run for the upcoming IPCC reports, IPCC AR5, that will be out in 2013, so quite soon. So all those simulations have been done. All the data, the output of the models simulations have been gathered. And lots of groups now are looking at those simulations. And something that is quite new from the previous IPCC exercise is that now many of the recent IPCC class models do include some marine biogeochemical components. The reason for that is not marine ecosystem studies, it's mostly because of the carbon cycle and climate linkages, but we can also look at those simulations to study biogeochemistry in general and marine ecosystems. Just one word on the scenarios that are used in these new simulations for the next IPCC report. Maybe some of you have been used to the stress scenarios that have been used for the past two reports, 2007 and 2001. Now we move to those new scenarios that are representative concentration pathways, that's the three letters. And you have numbers here that basically tell you how many watts per meter squared addition you have at the peak of the change. So 8.5 means that in 2100 you have plus 8.5 watts per square meters because of anthropogenic perturbations. And you can see here only one of the drivers, CO2 concentrations, in the four scenarios, 8.5, 6, 4.5, and 2.6. So the 8.5 is quite a pessimistic scenario if you want, with the atmospheric CO2 up to 900 ppm. And the 2.6 is a peak and decline scenario in which atmospheric CO2 doesn't reach more than 450 ppm. So I will mostly, to illustrate the results of my talk, use the RCP 8.5. That's the basically the easy way to look at the mechanisms simulated by the models. But of course, we have simulations with all those scenarios here. So outline of my talk, a few words on the marine biogeochemical models that are embedded in Earth system models, in climate models. Are they different from what we heard about this morning, for example, or yesterday? I will show the evolution of those models that are embedded in Earth system models over the past two decades. And then I will say a few words on evaluation of those models and explain why it's more complex to evaluate marine biogeochemical models embedded in Earth system models than marine biogeochemical models that are forced by observed analysis, for example. Then that's the core of my lecture here. I will say a few words about the changes in NPP driven by climate change and how this is simulated by the CENIC-5 models. So CENIC-5, that's the comparison exercise, so coupled modeling to comparison project that is used by IPCC AR5 to basically diagnose and project how climate will change under human perturbations. So changes in net current productivity driven by climate change, then I will focus on changes in pH and changes in oxygen. And I will mention some issues or challenges for the future. So in fact, the first models that have been used and embedded in climate models were very, very simple geochemical models. We cannot call them biogeochemical models if you want. In fact, the only biological equation that was embedded in these models is the following. The only flux, if you want, of interest was the flux of particles towards the deep ocean here, crossing the lithotic layer at 100 meters. And that's basically the flux that is important for RCCO2 fluxes on 100 timescales. So no matter, no interest in simulating explicitly phytoplankton here. And in those models that were developed in the 80s, beginning of the 90s, 1960s, the export production was computed as a function of temperature, of light, and of one nutrient, usually phosphate here, but it could be also nitrate. And those geochemical models were integrated in ocean general circulation models and were used in climate models, mostly to predict and compute Earth-sea CO2 fluxes here that would drive or would change atmospheric CO2. Then in the 90s, most of the climate groups, or some of the climate groups, did integrate a bit more complex geochemical models by representing explicitly phytoplanktons who contain some particles dissolved in the dissolved organic matter here. What we heard about this morning, MPZD and yesterday, so I guess you heard about MPZD and you'll be working on MPZD models this afternoon with the method. So in that case, most of the models still very simple with one nutrient, only one very generic phytoplankton, one generic zooplankton, dissolved particles. Maybe just illustration, I don't know if you've seen that yesterday, you could ask the reasons why we think we can represent all phytoplankton species by only one big generic group, and there are some good arguments to say that this is possible at some extent, and one of these arguments comes from the work of Epley in 1972. You have here the growth rate as a function of temperature for several individual species here of phytoplankton, and you see some cold species like this one, and some of course warmer species like this one, and Epley draw this curve here, that's an envelope curve, and basically that's what we use in the models to represent the influence of temperature on phytoplankton. So that's the way you can gather information you have on very different species to basically extract some general, maybe, relation between temperature and growth rate. So maybe it's easy for temperature, it may be more difficult for nutrients and for some other functions, but there is some ways to derive parameterizations for generic phytoplankton. Of course, this was too simple for most of the things that we are interested in now. And so the new generation of models, and some of the models that are now used by climate groups and in climate models, are dynamically, what we call dynamically green ocean models. And the phytoplankton group here has been split in different phytoplankton functional groups by size or by functions. We have also several zooplankton. And maybe the most important here, several nutrients, because we know it's not always the same nutrient limiting in the same regions of the ocean. And one big addition from phosphate or nitrate to this new generation of models is the addition of iron limitation here. That is very important in many regions of the world. But apart from that, the philosophy between those two different models is very, very similar. So you've heard about the BDC model yesterday, I guess, in the lecture by Marcus. I will show just a few evaluation results from this model, which is the PISCES model, which is very similar to the model you've been described, with two phytoplankton groups here, and two zooplankton groups, and the five main nutrients here. And so those models, so that's just the biotechnical part, but of course they are embedded in ocean general circulation models. And as Flourish was explaining this morning, we have these equations, and that's chlorophyll at the surface of the ocean, and at each time step you compute the evolution of the total chlorophyll that you have in each of the cells of your model here, based on advection, diffusion, and of course the biochemical processes. But now, and so what you can do is of course compare here surface chlorophyll from satellite observations to your model outputs. That's the first way you start to evaluate your model. You see that now we try to go, of course, a little bit further than that. That's, again, the PISCES model embedded in the ITSL climate model. So this time you have it in a climate model and you compare to observations. Maybe I want to mention this. So in the evaluation procedure, the first task is, of course, to compare to climatologies. And in that case, you will focus on mean state and seasonal cycle of chlorophyll, of course, but also nutrient, oxygen, some other variables. And the big question is this evaluation, is this relevant for centriscale projections? If your model performs very well for the seasonal cycle, does this mean that it will be better for projections? So basically we try to find other ways to evaluate the models on longer timescales, and maybe timescales relevant to what we have interest in. So the other second step here is, of course, to use internal to decode validity in some of these variables here to evaluate the models. Of course, when you go back in the past, it's more and more difficult because you have fewer and fewer data. You can do that for maybe internal validity, but decode validity in profile, you have only 15 years of data, satellite observations, it's not enough to look at decode validity. And another point of difficulty is the fact that the Earth system models, they generate their own climates. And so the internal variability in the data and in the ESM, in the Earth system model, are not in phase. So the climate model wind generates its own El Niños, El Niñas. So you cannot say, let's look at 97 in the data and 97 in the model. Because of course, there is no reason why the model would have an El Niño in 97. So you have to find clever ways to compare internal validity as observed and as simulated by the ESMs. And then another way to evaluate the models is to turn to longer time scales and use the paleo data records. And of course, that's also very difficult because those data are very sparse and usually indirect. So it's only proxies of some of the variables that you simulate. And of course, the simulations also are sometimes very incomplete because you don't have a complete understanding of all the forcings on different variables. So I will illustrate evaluation of Earth system models with two techniques here, one using internal variability and another one using some longer time scales with paleo data records. So that's based on two papers here. So the first one is basically using something that is very well known. It's the variability of primary productivity as observed by or as seen by the satellites, and for example by Berenfeld et al. In 2006. And Berenfeld was showing this clear correlation between anomalies in NTP, in gray here, from 97 to 2006, and anomalies of stratification in the tropical ocean here in red. So you have here a clear El Niño signal, low productivity, and a stratified tropical ocean. And you have here the La Niña times, if you want, positive NTP anomaly, and so here the axis is in reverse order, and with the destratification of the tropical ocean. So in your ESL, you cannot compare this event, but you can compare the statistical relationship between some physical drivers and the response of marine biogeochemistry. So that's what we've done with the IPSL PISCES global models, and you have here the relation between destratification index and the anomalies of NTP in the tropical ocean, 40 south to 40 north, as seen by the data in black from 97 to 2005, and as simulated by your model here in red. And you see that even if the model is not reproducing high El Niño events like the ones that we observed in 97, the relation between changes in NTP and changes in stratification here are quite well reproduced by the model. So that's the way you can use internal variability as observed here by satellites and your model to do some evaluation. And even at the local scale, that's a correlation map, local NPP versus the stratification index, so some global value here, that's from the satellite observations and that's from the model. So you see that you find the same kind of big dipoles with when you go into an El Niño event, you have less productivity here, but more productivity in the Eastern Indian and the Western Pacific here, and that's partly introduced by the model. So you can look at like global diagnostics here, but also at the local scale. Another way to evaluate the models is to turn to the past. And here, we've used the centennial variability of productivity as recorded by sediment core. So for that, we focused on some specific events that are called IREC events. I don't know if all of you know what's an IREC events. So those events have been recorded in the past 100 kilo years here, so that's the present time. You go to the past on the left here. And in the North Atlantic, the sediment course of the North Atlantic, we have six times a very high percentage of detrital carbonates. And we think, or the paleoceanographers, they think that these detritus have been brought here by big iceberg discharges. So these events here, IREC events, are linked to iceberg discharges in the North Atlantic. And they are recorded also in all the climate records of the Northern Hemisphere. So after this IREC events in the North Atlantic, you have a very strong cooling of Europe modification of the circulation in the North Atlantic. So those are big events taking place of maybe a few hundreds of years, maybe 1,000 years. So on time scales, maybe relevant to what we will be seeing in the next decades and centuries. But few informations on biologic nickel cycles on these events. That's the information that I've been gathered here. From 40 segment cores, you have modifications of productivity, and you have some clear signal. In the North Atlantic, most of the cores clearly say that after an arctic events, you have a decrease in productivity, maybe an increase in productivity in the Southern Ocean here, and less productivity in the North Pacific, Indian Ocean. So that's very qualitative, but it gives you some response to those big climate events in terms of marine productivity. So we run the model, basically simulating an idealized Heinrich event here, and then we can compare qualitatively the changes in MPP that respond to Heinrich events and the gathered information here. And you see that in the North Atlantic, if you bring lots of fresh water, you will change the stratification and you will decrease MPP as the sediment cores will tell you. In the Southern Ocean, it's a bit more patchy here, but you have also this seesaw, this dipole between the North Atlantic Southern Ocean that is reproduced by the model. Indian Ocean, North Pacific, mainly the model is also reproducing part of the changes that are observed. So that's the start of those kind of things, but it's a way to evaluate the models in different climates, long time scales, maybe more relevant to centennial changes that we'll be seeing. Okay, that was the first part. Now I turn to climate change impact on marine productivity. So the first kind of results that were obtained on that topic were using very simple models, that the one I was mentioning in the beginning, geochemical model, you know, only export production, and in very idealized scenarios. So you have PCO2 here increasing from maybe 350 to almost 700 in 70 years, 1% per year, and SST is responding, clear warming here on the surface ocean, and that's the delta production, so changes in MPP. So that was published more than 10 years ago, and basically the three models that we were using at the time were all simulating a decreasing global MPP in response to climate change. The interesting story maybe at the time was this strong opposition between the low latitudes that respond to climate change by decreasing export production or even primary productivity, and the high latitudes here in the North Pacific and in the Southern Ocean responding to climate change by increasing productivity over a time scale of something like 100 years. So global decrease, -5 to -10%, but a strong opposition between low and mid latitudes that you can see here on the zonal mean. So the changes in export production from 2 times CO2, -1 times CO2, five different models here, +30% and -20%. So significant and big changes in MPP responding in response to. So that was 10 years ago. Now if you turn to the new generation of couple models, so the semi-5 generation, and here I plot the changes in MPP in relative units from 2005 to 2100 in the RCP 8.5 scenario, which is the high-end scenario. And I have, I think, 8 models here. We will have more than that very soon, but at the time we had 8 models here. And you see that all models, they predict or they project the decrease of MPP with climate change. Of course, some differences here in 2100, but you have a global decrease of MPP by -5 to -20% in 2100. So very similar to what was obtained with much simpler models than you. If you look at the regional distribution of those changes in MPP, you have again increasing MPP in red, decreasing MPP in blue, and that's the changes from 2005 to 2100, and that's an ensemble model mean. So I've basically averaged the 8 models here, and the hatched regions that you have here, that's the black dots here, they tell you when more than 75% of the models agree on the sign of change. So it gives you like a measure of the confidence or on the uncertainty you have on your model projections. And you have some clear signals here in those maps with a large decrease in productivity in the North Atlantic simulated by all the models. In all the models also you have a clear decrease in MPP in the tropical oceans, And in all the models also you have an increasing MPP in the Southern Ocean here close to the Antarctic continent, but also here between 45 and 50 south. So again, new models, more complex in terms of biogeochemistry, new climate models. We still have this large regional contrast with decrease in MPP up to minus 50% in the North Atlantic, decrease in the tropics, and increase in the Southern Ocean. You have also regions where the models just don't agree. It's the case in the Arctic that I haven't shown here. You have half of the models saying more MPP and half of the models saying less MPP. So, of course, there are clear regions where we don't understand anything.
They all have dynamic tests?
Sorry?
They all have dynamic tests?
They all have dynamic tests.
Laura, can you also explain the reasons of this increases or decreases?
Yes. I come to that.
Okay.
Another interesting thing is to compare this new intercomparison to what was published in 2011 with the previous generation of models. So we had at that time five models. So you have no common models between those maps, and still you see some very similar patterns here, large decrease in the North Atlantic, in the tropical oceans here, and increase in the South Ocean. So this new CEMIC 5 model class, if you want, give in terms of changes in MPP in response to climate change very similar results to previous other intercomparison study. So now I come to maybe the mechanism. So we can explain this in a very simple way, this contrast between low latitudes and high, low and mid latitudes and high latitudes. So in low latitudes, where MPP is mostly limited by the availability of nutrients in the water, climate change will drive a strong stratification of the ocean because you warm the surface of the water, so you decrease density, and you end up with more stratification. And if you have more stratification, you have less nutrient coming from below, and because of reduced mixing, lower nutrient supply, you decrease plankton biomass and fertility in the surface ocean. So that's what's happening in the North Atlantic and in the tropical oceans in all the global models that we've looked at so far. At higher latitudes, in the Southern Ocean, and in some models in the Arctic Ocean, you have more productivity, and that's basically because in those regions, productivity is mostly light limited. So if you melt the sea ice, you have more light. And of course, if you stratify the ocean, if you reduce the mixing, you will have an increase in plankton in the eliminated surface waters that will drive more productivity. So you may have the same physical driver, stratification, with different outcome depending on the regions where this is at.
Why did they increase the saturation in the waters?
So what I've shown was integrated MPP before. So this would encompass all the subsurface and surface. Of course, what we have, so we have things, interesting things. You may have, so yeah, if I come back here, so that's just MPP. But if you look at chlorophyll, the distribution on the vertical of chlorophyll, of biomasses, you have very interesting things depending on the regions you look at. For example, what we have here in those models is an extension of the oligotrophic gyres. You have also a deepening of the subsurface chlorophyll maximum here in the oligotrophic gyres. So that's only an integrated view, 2D, but you can really look at the 3D and you have some very similar results by the different models. We consider also the horizontal, of course. So this can play a role, but the first order from what we've looked at, so then it depends on the region. If you go in an upper regions, it's not the vertical mixing, it will be really the really density that will drive. So it's really advection that will drive the changes in nutrient delivery. In the North Atlantic, it seems that really it's almost a 1D process, vertical mixing, but of course advection will play a role. And in all those models, so we have them embedded in OGCM, so we have, of course, vertical advection, horizontal advection. Okay, just another point. I've shown you that those models can represent different phytoplankton groups. So we've started to look at the changes in the ratio between the different phytoplankton functional groups that we have. And here, that's French, sorry. We have the impact of climate change on phytoplankton communities using the PISCAS model I was showing you before. And in blue, it means that you have a reduction of the relative proportion of diatoms compared to the small phytoplankton. what do models, not only in this case, but some other models, tell us so that with climate change you have maybe more small cells and less of the bigger cells. And that is very intuitive. If you have more MPP, you would guess that you would have less bigger cells. So there's another study here by Boyd and Donnet, in which they looked at N2 fixation, so another plankton functional group, and fixers in the ocean in 2002 with a previous version of the NCAR magic chemical model. And they showed here that with climate change and with warming at the surface, you will have here more N2 fixation. So we start to look at the relative proportion of those different phytoplankton groups. Few words on ocean acidification now and changes in pH. So I don't know if you mentioned that already yesterday, not at all.
Maybe.
So maybe I skip the introduction part. So the ocean is absorbing anthropogenic carbon, mostly in the North Atlantic here, but also in the Southern Ocean, in the Pacific. And of course, this changes the chemistry of the ocean. And when you have more CO2 into the water, you have more bicarbonate ion, but less carbonate ion. And it's the less carbonate ion that will impact classification, because it's here. Because of course, when an organism is calcified, it uses calcium ions here and carbonate to form calcite or other compounds. So a way to look at this acidification is to look at the horizon saturation of calcite. I don't know if you're familiar with this concept here. In a few words, the ocean is split into two big parts. The surface of the ocean is oversaturated in regards to aragonite or to calcite, which are two forms of CaCO3. And you have an horizon saturation, and below the horizon, you are undersaturated in regards to aragonite or calcite. And so what the increasing CO2 will do in the ocean is, of course, increasing CO2, decreasing pH, decreasing carbonate ion, and it will short the horizon saturation. So you will end up with a much larger volume of undersaturated waters compared to oversaturated waters. And of course, in undersaturated waters, the skeletons, the shells, start to dissolve just chemically. So this is an interesting result from a big field in 2004 published in Science. They were basically computing the depths of the horizon saturation today and in the past to try to show if the saturation depths have changed with the increasing CO2. So you have so that's the Atlantic, the Pacific, and the Indian, three sections here. In color you have anthropogenic carbon, which is only a small part of total dissolved inorganic carbon, but you clearly see the penetration of anthropogenic carbon mostly in the North Atlantic here, but also in the Pacific, and the Indian Ocean. And here you have two curves. The plane curve here in red is today's more present horizon saturation for aragonite. In white it's for calcite. So separating oversaturated waters here and undersaturated waters here. And the dotted or dashed line here are the horizon saturations for pre-industrial states. So basically they've estimated anthropogenic carbon, they removed the anthropogenic carbon from the total carbon, and they recomputed the horizon saturation just with the natural carbon. And they were showing that the horizon saturation has already shown by as much as a few hundred meters in the Southern Ocean, in the North Pacific also. So now if I turn to projections, one of the first papers is the one by Wolf Lagrueta in 1999, using this business as usual scenario here, increasing CO2 in the atmosphere. And that's for the surface ocean. It was showing that if you increase CO2 from 280 to 650 here, pH will decrease by 0.4 units. So that's a huge change in pH at the surface ocean. But if you look at carbonate ion concentrations, it's even worse because you go from, so that's the axis for carbonate ion, you go from 250 here to maybe 125. So it's a decrease by 50% of the carbonate ion concentration at the surface of the ocean. So what does that mean on the vertical? That's a plot from the paper by Jim Moore et al. In 2005. That's the situation in 1994. From the data, So same plots that in the field data that I just showed, penetration of androgenic carbon in the Atlantic and in the Pacific, and showing about the horizon saturation here in the Southern Ocean and in the Northern Atlantic here. And that's the situation in 2100 for two scenarios. So we have, of course, much more androgenic carbon in the ocean. And look at the showing of the horizon saturation. We are here in the North Atlantic. You go from 3,000, that's for our argument, you go from 3,000 meters to maybe 2,700 meters in 1994. And then in the next decades, if the CO2 increases as in those scenarios, we'll have an horizon saturation maybe at a few hundred meters or even a few tens of meters here in 2100. And what was Jim Moore showing also is that this horizon saturation could reach the surface of the ocean in the Southern Ocean and also in the North Pacific. So we could have undersaturated waters all over the water column from the surface to the deep of the ocean. So that was all scenarios with all the models. What do the new Semic 5 models tell us? Again, the same approximately 8 models here, and that's the changes in pH from 1850 to 2100 here for two different scenarios, the RCP 8.5 and the RCP 4.5, and then even for those two scenarios we have extensions up to 2300 here. So what you can see from that is that all models, they project a consistent decrease in pH from all the Semic 5 models. You have three regions here, the Arctic in dark blue, the Southern Ocean in light blue, and the tropics in red. And this decrease in pH will be higher in the Arctic and in the Southern Ocean than in the tropics. Maybe the last plot from the Semic 5 models is the following. In the tropics, we are far at the surface, again, we are far away from undersaturation, which is not the case in the Arctic or in the Southern Ocean. And you see here that in the RCP 8.5 scenario, we crossed the threshold of aragonite undersaturation in the middle of this century for the Arctic, maybe even like in 2020, 2030, depending on the model, and even reached the calcite undersaturation at the surface in the Arctic before the end of the century. So these results are quite consistent with what we had in the previous simulations. Of course, this has strong implications on calcification and trophic food webs in those polar regions, especially because of the impact on calcifications. Another impact that has not been studied so far is the fact that this acidification will increase mainly the ratios of carbon to nitrogen in the organic matter. And this can change the food quality in all the trophic fluids. So that's another kind of impact of acidification.
The whole results were in the organic 5, I mean the problem.
Yeah.
So the active biology didn't make any difference.
But for that biology doesn't make any difference. Even in the in those previous results, basically there were no real biogeochemical models. The biogeochemical models were very simple, just geochemical models basically. But embedded in full OGCN. If you look at these results here, it's quite similar to what we had in OPM5. Maybe if you look at the year at which you cross the threshold, you have some differences between models that may be due to the fact that the way they represent the carbonate cycle. But this is second order. Okay, a few words on oxygen and deoxygenation, or desoxygenation, I don't know how to say it in English. Deoxygenation. We see, sometimes you see both. Deoxygenation. Okay. So this deoxygenation business is quite recent, but in fact it was already mentioned quite a while ago by Sarmiento et al. In 1998. At that time they were copying a geochemical model in the ocean with a climate model, and they were looking at the response of the ocean carbon cycle to anthropogenic warming. But that's the last paragraph of this paper in Nature in 1998. At that time already, he was mentioning a global mean decrease of oxygen between 1990 and 2065 in one scenario, with at a depth of 1600 meters here in the Southern Ocean, large regions with large decrease of more than 20 millimolar. So this was identified quite a while ago. And over the past years, there have been a few O2 focused studies with coupled climate biogeochemical models. models. And those models, they show large ocean deoxygenation with global warming, mostly at high and mid latitudes, and changes that are mostly driven by ocean dynamics and physics, and also by warming because you reduce the solubility. So why do we care about oxygen? You've seen maybe those curves, and Marcus mentioned oxygen zone, I guess. And of course, the two main reasons why we focus on oxygen is because of the role in the oxygen or denitrification of N2O production. And the other strong role here is, of course, the impact on ecosystems. And the Keeling et al. Paper, that's a review paper on ocean deoxygenation, published in 2010, you have this figure showing the median lethal oxygen concentrations for animals here from crustacea, fishes, bivalve, and gastropoda. And you see the concentrations here, we are between maybe 20, 30 in here up to 50, 60. So that are the numbers we'll be looking at in the coming years. So that's the equator Pacific oxygen zone. We are at, I think, 400 meters here. And you see the numbers 10, 20, 30 that are even lower than what we had on the previous plots. So clearly, some of these animals, they avoid being in those oxygen zones. And what Strama was showing in 2008 with data here from the beginning of the 60s to today is an extension on the vertical on this oxygen zone in the tropics. That's the deep point, so it's here in almost in the core of this oxygen zone. So the 60 micromolar limit here is showing at the top of the OMZ, and it's deepening at the bottom of the OMZ. So you have an extension in volume of the OMZ. That's what the data tell us. So I have to say that there are not so many data points here. So to get this picture, we need lots of interpolation, extrapolation of the existing data. So this is partly still discussed in the community. So what do the models tell us on the evolution of O2 in the ocean with climate change? So they, as I was mentioning, they simulate deoxygenation in response to climate change. And I show you an early results that we obtained some time ago with a simple model. You have, that's the O2 flux to the atmosphere. So in pre-industrial times, you're equilibrated. You don't lose oxygen, you don't gain oxygen from the ocean. And with climate change, you start to lose oxygen to the atmosphere in the 21st century. And in 2100, the decrease in oxygen content for the entire ocean is between -1 and -7%, depending on the different models. So that's the previous generation of models. And the mechanisms, again, decreased O2 solubility everywhere at the surface, of course. And we have also circulation changes and stratification that will amplify this solubility response. And if you quantify those two drivers here, it's maybe 1.25% due to the solubility and up to 3/4 due to circulation changes and stratification. So the new models, the new simplified models, they tell us basically the same story. That's the changes in O2 content of the ocean under the RCP 8.5 scenario. And that's relative changes, of course, then you can put all the models on the same graph. And again, the same 8 models here that I had, 7 models that I had at the time. And they all show this clear decrease in oxygen with climate change and with global warming. You have one outlier here that I still don't know how to explain, but I hope I will be able to
That's the model.
That's one of our versions. So we hope
that's the technology
work on that. So of course that's very consistent, decreasing the oxygen content of the ocean. When you turn to the 2D views, so that's oxygen, so at the surface it's very similar because they warm everywhere, increase oxygen everywhere on the surface, that's not very interesting. What's interesting is to look at what happens in the main thermocline. So here we're between 100 and 600 meters, and we look at changes in O2 between the end of the century and 2005 from the same 7 models under the RCP 8.5 scenarios. And again, I've used these hatched regions to show where more than 75, maybe 80% of the models agree on the sign of change. And you have a very clear response in the North Pacific, the North Atlantic, and the Southern Ocean. All models show much less oxygen at subsurface with climate change, that mostly a response to changes in circulation, ventilation, and stratification. In the tropics, signals are less clear, with even more oxygen in the Indian and the Atlantic Ocean. And this seems to be a consistent response across all the models. We have more oxygen between 100 and 600 meters here in the regions. So that's one thing. Another big signal, La Niña, El Niño, it seems that they get. So the question is, for the long term NPP over the entire tropical ocean or by big basins, is that relevant? Or do we need to focus more on time series stations? I guess we need both. So, still some work to do, of course.
Yes. There's also a question you'd like.
No, go ahead.
Yes. Okay, so if I understand that right, in the first part of your report, or towards the beginning, you said that the new version of the IPCC model, the new report, gets sort of the same changes as the old version, the old models that were used for the previous report? Sort of similar order of magnitude?
For what kind of predictions? NTP or?
Yeah, I think it was NTP.
So to be clear, the older generation of models used for IPCC, the official models, they were not including any biogeochemistry chemistry. So there were really models with biogeochemistry chemistry in the ocean, but not for IPCC directly. So now, so basically you could go to the IPCC or to the SEMI3 at the time database, no ocean biogeochemical variables were available. And now it has changed. Maybe half of the model they have ocean magic in the components.
They were similar only for the saturation depth changes.
What?
The saturation depth changes.
Yeah. No, but for MPP also it's not so different what we have. For the main patterns of changes in MPP.